Death is real. Someone's there and then they're not. And it's not for singing about. It's not for making into art. When real death enters the house, all poetry is dumb. When I walk in to the with your name on it came, and inside was a gift for our daughter you had ordered in secret and collapsed there on the front steps. I wailed. A backpack for when she goes to school a couple years from now. You were thinking ahead to a future you must have known deep down would not include you. Though you clawed at the cliff, you were sliding down, being swallowed into a silence that's bottomless and real. It's dumb, and I don't want to learn anything from this. I love you. Our daughter is 1.5. You have been dead 11 days. I got on the boat and came to the place where the three of us were going to build our house. If you had lived, you died though. So I came here. Our baby in the dust of your bones. I can't remember. Were you into Canada geese? Is it significant? These hundreds on the beach. Or were they just hungry for mid-migration seaweed? What about foxgloves? Is that a flower you liked? I can't remember. You did most of my remembering for me. And now I stand untethered in a field full of wild foxgloves, wondering if you're there or if a flower means anything. And what could anything mean? Crushing absurdity. I brought a chair from home. I'm leaving it on the hill, facing west and north, and I poured out your ashes on it, I guess so you can watch the sunset. But the truth is I don't think of that dust as you. You are the sunset. I was out in the yard. I'd just finished splitting up the scrap 2x4s into kindling. I glanced up at the half moon, pink chill refinery cloud light. Two big blackbirds flew over, their wings whooshing in low. But only two, their black feathers tinted in the sunset. I knew these birds were omens, but of what I wasn't sure. They were flying out toward the island where we hoped to move. You were probably inside. You were probably aching, wanting not to die. Your body transformed. I couldn't bear to look, so I turned my head west like an early death. Fridge in lifeless pictures, and in every dream I have at night, and in every room I walk into, like here, where I sit the next October, still seeing your eyes, pleading and afraid, full of love, calling out from another place, because you're not here. I watched you die in this room, then I gave your clothes away. I'm sorry, I had to.
Ourselves in the moss there.
together was not long. You had cancer and you were killed, and I'm left living like this, crying on the logging roads with your ashes in a jar, thinking about the things I'll tell you when you get back from wherever it is that you've gone. But then I remember death is real, and I'm still here in Massive. August 12th, 2016. You've been dead for 1 month and 3 days, and we are sleeping in the forest. There is sand still in the blankets from the beach where we released you from the jar. When we wake up, all the clothes that we left out are cold and damp just from up, surrounded by growth, nurse logs with layers of moss and life, young cedars, the sound of water, thick salal, and godlike huckleberries. The ground absorbs and remakes whatever falls. Nothing dies here, but here is where I came to grieve, to dive into it with you, with your absence, but I keep picking you berries.
Burning the understory, erasing trails, there is no end. But when I'm kneeling in the heat, throwing out your underwear, the devastation is not natural or good. You do belong here. I reject nature. I disagree. In the hazy light of forest fire smoke, I looked across at the refineries and thought that the world was actually constantly ending, and the smell and roar of the asphalt truck that was idling just out the window, tearing up our street. I missed you, of course. And I remember thinking the last time it rained here, alive still, and that this same long heat that I was in contained you. And in the same heat, I open the window next to you on your last morning, so you could breathe, and then so you could ghost away. And now, so the room will hopefully stop whispering. The grind of time, I'm not keeping up with. The leaf on the ground pokes at my slumbering. Grief walking around, severed lumbering. But slowly, sovereignty reasserts itself. I don't want it though. And betrayal whines, who and how could I live?
The echoes.
Today our daughter asked me if Mama swims. I told her, yes, she does. And that's probably all she does now. What was you is now born across waves, evaporating. I am a container of stories about you, and I bring you up repeatedly, uninvited to. Do the people around me wanna keep hearing about my dead wife? Or does the room go silent when I mention you shining alive? I live with your absence, and it's been 2 months since you died. I'll speak to your absence and carry our stories around my whole life. But when I'm in public, I don't know what's that look in their eyes. I now wield the power to transform a grocery store aisle into a canyon of pity and confusion and mutual aching to leave. In my life is a chasm I take into town, and I don't want to close it. Look at me. Death is real. When I take out the garbage at night, I'm not with you then, exactly. I'm with the universe, and with the lightning and thunder coming in over the mountains. But when I walk back into the house, looking up at the window from the back step, the dark window of the room that you died in, the big empty room on the second floor. Because I won't close the window, just in case something still needs to leave. I stand in the yard and look up. And the dark rectangle blares your face. All of our moments condensed into a thunder clap. When I take out the garbage at night and then have to go back in and live on. Talk about back before I knew my way around these hospitals. I would like to forget and go back into imagining that snow shining permanently alone could say something. Just felt it for the first time. 3 months and 1 day after you died, I realized that these photographs we have of you are slowly replacing the subtle familiar memory of what it's like to know you're in the other room, to hear you singing on the stairs, a movement, a pine cone, your squeaking chair, the quiet untreasured. In between times, the actual experience of you here, I can feel these memories escaping, colonized by photos narrowed down and told, my mind erasing the echo of you in the house dies down. Slow pulsing red tower lights across a distance, refuge in the dust. All my life I can remember longing, looking across the water and seeing light. When I was 5 or 6, we were camping in the islands in July. The tall yellow grass and the rose hips fragrant after sunset, island beyond island, undulating and familiar, not far from home, with my fragrant whittled cedar driftwood dagger in the mildew canvas tent. I saw fireworks many miles away, but didn't hear them, and I felt a longing, a childish melancholy, and then I went to sleep, and the aching was buried, dreaming, aging, reaching for an idea of somewhere other than this place that could fold me in clouded yearning. For nowhere actually reachable, the distance was the point. And then when I was 24, I followed this ache to an Arctic Norwegian cabin where I said, fuck the world, in a finally satisfying way. I stayed through the winter and emerged as an adult, holding a letter from you, an invitation. So I flew back and drove back, and when we met in person, it was instant. It didn't matter where we lived, as long as we were together, and that was really true. For 13 years, and the whole time still, slow pulsing red tower lights across a distance, refuge in the dust, in January you were alive still. But chemo had ravaged and transformed your porcelain into some other thing, something jaundiced and fucked. They put you in the hospital in Everett, so I gave the baby away and drove up and down I-5 every night like a satellite, bringing you food that you wanted, returning at night to sleep in our bed, cold. I went back to feel alone there, all past selves and future possibilities on hold, while I tore through the dark on the freeway. The old yearning burning in me, I knew exactly where trees opened up, and I could see way above the horizon, beyond innumerable islands, the towers on top of the mountain lit up, slowly, silently beaconing, as if to say, just going. There is a place where a wind could erase this for you, and the branches could white noise you back awake. So I went back to feel alone there, but cradled you in me. There's a painting called Soria Moria. A kid looks across a deep canyon of fog at a lit up inhuman castle or something. I have not stopped looking across the water from a few difficult spots where you can see that the distance from this haunted house where I live to Soria Moria is a real traversable space. I'm an arrow now, midair. Pulsing red tower lights across a distance, refuge in the dust. Sweet kid, what is this world we're giving you? Smoldering and fascist with no mother. Are you dreaming about a crow? In the middle of November, we went back into the woods right after breakfast to see if we could see this past August's forest fire zone. On the hill above the lake, the sky was low and the wind cold. The trail was closed. At the barricade, I stood listening. In my backpack, you were sleeping with her hat pulled low. All the usual birds were gone or freezing. It was all silent, except the sound of one crow following us as we wove through the cedar grove. I walked and you bobbed and dozed. Sweet kid, we were watched and followed, and I thought of Genevieve. Sweet kid, I heard you murmur in your sleep. Crow, you said. Crow, and I asked, are you dreaming about a crow? And there she was.